When I look around and see the good things He's done for me, I know that I'm unworthy of Him all. But His blessing He freely gives, I owe my whole life to Him. I've got so much to thank Him for. And I've got so much to thank Him for, so much to praise Him for. You see, He has been so good to me. And when I think of what He's done and where He's brought me from, I've got so much to thank Him for. And sometimes while on this way I stop just to kneel and say, Lord, thank You for all You've done for me. And then one day I'll reach sweet heaven shore. Oh, please just let me kneel once more. I've got so much to thank Him for. And I've got so much to thank Him for, so much to praise Him for. You see, He has been so good to me. And when I think of what He's done and where He's brought me from, I've got so much to thank Him for.
Ask our ushers to come forward this time to receive this evening's offering. Brother Riel, will you come ask the blessing over the offering for us?
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, God, we just come thanking you, Lord, for just your presence here this morning, God. We just praise you for your goodness, God. We thank you for answered prayer, God, and moving in hearts and lives, God. And we ask you, God, tonight to move in a mighty and a fresh way, God. We thank you for the blessings this morning, but yet we look forward to what you're going to do tonight, God. God, we just pray your Holy Spirit would move and be in the speaking, God, that your Holy Spirit would speak to each and every heart, God, that you would just draw us all close to you, God, and move us closer, God, that we might become more, just more godly women and men, Father, for you. And God, tonight, if there's one that don't know you, God, we pray that you'd open their eyes and their heart tonight to you, God, and to what you have in their lives, God. And we just pray, Lord, that you'd bless this offering, God, use it for your kingdom's sake. We ask it all in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore, and I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, and I'll. The shadows
I'm gonna start wearing a hard hat up here.
When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, and I'll fly away. Oh, fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Turn around and shake hands with your neighbor this evening.
Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end, and I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, and I'll.
Be seated.
You do that last verse again. Today over at Smoky Mountain High School, there was 27 students give their heart to Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what prayer do right there. Let's stand to our feet all over the building. God's been good today. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah.
I came so empty. No place to call my own. There was no one who really loved me. Oh, but now look what I hold. I'm feasting on the manna that comes from God on high. And there is no shortage. There is a vast supply. With not much, but thanks be to God, you're leaving better off than how you came in. Even in the worst day, even in the worst trial, every single one of us have been adopted into a new family if you're saved by the grace of God. And the Bible said that we're not only heirs, but joint heirs, Brother Ken, to a royal kingdom. Isn't it good to be saved tonight? I feel like having church on a Sunday night.
I came so empty-handed, no place to call. That means I didn't deserve it. There was no one who really loved me. Oh, but now look what I own. I'm feasting on the manna that comes from God on high. And there is no shortage. There is a vast supply. Now I'm no longer an orphan. Someone has rescued me. My garments no longer are tattered. My family is royalty.
Sing it again, brother. Thank the Lord.
Once my clothes were ragged, the world looked down on me. I had no hope for tomorrow, nor for eternity. Then grace came with mercy and heard this orphan's plea. Now I've been adopted, from bondage I've been set free. it's been taken care of. When the Lord, He took my place with mercy and grace. Mercy and grace wiped all my frown. He put a song in its place. Mercy and grace.
Good to be back in the house of the Lord tonight. I got so full of the Spirit of the Lord this morning, I didn't know if I was going to pass out or what. I'm telling you, what a service we had. And as a lot of our young people came back tonight, and we're going to give them this time to come say a word for the Lord and whatever God had put on their heart. So, y'all just come on right now. I know a couple of you talked to me before.
First off, I'd like to thank God for saving me a long time ago. And I want to tell you guys how it happened. I went into the service. It's kind of funny. I didn't really think anything about it. And I was just going to go to church service because, well, that's what you do when you're a preacher's kid. So I was in there, and I sit down, and I usually sit with my grandparents. And I looked over at Gran. I said, "I got to go pray." She was like, "Okay, well, go on." I was like, "No, I want to go get saved." And she was like, "Okay, well, I'll go tell your daddy." And she went and told Dad, and you ought to have seen the look on his face. He's like, so I went up there, and I got saved. I quoted after Dad. I sounded like Callie, crying. And since that day, I had been praying for my uncle, because I knew that he was out in the world and doing all kinds of bad stuff. And I prayed. And I'd come down here, and I'd pray on these altars, and it seemed like it wouldn't happen. Like, it was hitting the roof and come back down. But this morning, when I saw him come up here, it was kind of like God said, "I told you so. I told you I'd do it." So, thankful for him coming up here. He said if I don't come down and see him soon, he'd cut me. So, I'm glad that he rededicated his life this morning. And that's all I got to say.
Amen.
And I sing the song a lot, so.
If you need free. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. But we've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. But there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain,
some noise tonight.
Somebody testify, testify. You got pain. Yeah, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, yeah, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, we're saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, we've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night, and we've all found ourselves worn out.
Feels good to be free, don't it, sister? Hallelujah. Hold both hands up, praise Him. There's a girl delivered from addiction right there. Hallelujah.
But there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, yeah, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, yeah, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, we're saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, yeah, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it,
yeah.
If you can't feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can't feel it, somebody testify. You got pain, yeah, he's a pain taker.
Yes.
If you feel lost,
hallelujah, he is.
Yeah, he's a way maker.
He's a way maker.
If you need freedom, oh, saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, yeah, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you got pain, if you feel lost,
God praise. One of you other young people, come on. Hey, Braden, just stay up here, buddy. And another young person, get ready after him, okay? Let's keep this service going. Come on.
I want to ask everybody if they would stand right now.
Get into my yard.
Would y'all look at the American flag and do the pledge with me? I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
In that pledge, there's something that says one nation under God. And I think everybody in here can agree with me that we're losing our privileges as Christians, and we need to stand up because the devil has ran through everywhere that we know. He's ran through the schools, and it's not just public schools and Christian schools too.
There you go.
Even at my school, I mean, we've got the Christians and we've got the people that claim Christianity. We had people come in and bring alcohol to school. We had one do it last week, and it's just awful that somebody can claim Christianity and then bring something like that to a school, a Christian school, and be underage even, not even above the age of 18 and be doing it. It's just, I don't see how somebody could live with themselves, and I thank God for my parents because I know if I would have done that, and I thank them for raising me and teaching me how to read the Bible and praying with me when I felt like I couldn't go nowhere, when I felt just like that I had nothing to do in life, that I had no point, that there was just nothing I could do, that my parents would just help me. They would pick me up when my head was down. And it's just amazing what they've done in my life and how they've helped me. And it's just our church family too. We know how to go get God. God is in here. He's in here. He's in this very room right now. And if God's in this room, why don't we give him praise? Why don't we give him praise?
Yes, he is.
I don't know about y'all, but I love my parents too, but I've not got it in me to hang on a tree and have myself beat, have myself yelled at, and just be beat just because of how much I love somebody. That's love. If he's going to hang on a tree and have people beat him and his guts hanging out, you could see his bones. If he's going to do that, he loves us. I don't think we realize that in our new culture where it's okay to go out here and smoke weed or drink. It's against God. If God loves us that much, he loves sinners too. It's not just the saints. We all used to sin. We are all sinners still. But God has wrote our name down if we're saved in the Lamb's Book of Life. Our sins are forgiven because one day he went up there and hung on the cross. And he took up our sins and he died. And then he rose. He rose himself. I mean, there's nobody that powerful that can raise himself from the dead. They thought they would kill him. Satan thought he'd won, but he hadn't won. And he thinks he's going to win now, but when we die, we're either going to heaven or hell. And I thank God that I'm going to heaven, that one day I got a hold of Jesus over here in this little altar. It was about a year ago to the day. It was a year ago on Trunk or Treat. Chris had preached a message that was Halloween. And I remember going up to pray with somebody, and then I realized that I was lost and that if I didn't get saved, that I was going to hell.
Bless you, Lord.
And then I had to realize that if I don't get saved, that I'm not promised tomorrow. I'm not even promised the end of this speech right now. We're not promised the next second. I don't think that we realize that in our new culture. I don't think we realize that we're living in the last days and what's coming up. It's just our nation is not under God. We have plenty of Christians. We have plenty of them. We've still got people that love God with all their heart, like Chris and Kyle and everybody up here and Ken and others. We still have people that love God with all their heart, but we have people that have let the devil run their life down, that have believed every single lie the devil's told them and won't listen to God. And I don't think they realize that one day that they're going to go to hell. And it's our job as Christians to go to them and preach. I mean, we're told we all have our callings in life. We all have our strong and weak points. But we can all share the gospel with somebody. Some of us might not be able to do it by memory, but we can have a Bible. Everybody's got their phone on them usually when they're in town. I mean, you can get your Bible on that. And we need to realize how bad it is. I'm happy that I'm not going to hell, but I mean, how could you pass people every day knowing that they're going to go to somewhere like that? That they're going to die and go to hell. We pass people like that every day, and we don't, like, I've been with Chris, and he'll do it, be in a store or something, and somebody's not doing something in a Christian way or in the right way that they should be, and then he'll go up to him, and he don't confront him in a bad way. That's another big thing that we need to realize. You don't go up to somebody and tell them they're stupid and just beat them down with your words and then tell them, hey, Jesus loves you and I love you. That's not love. It's not when you tell someone. You approach them right. I mean, some of us realize that. And it's just ridiculous how we can think that we can live with ourselves telling people all this. And then we're going out here in the world, and we're gone out in the world, and it's just crap. The devil has run down everything about, I mean, there's good churches like ours. Ours is a great church. You come here and Chris is going to preach a sermon, or Kyle's going to preach a sermon with conviction. And we need to preach conviction. There's people watching online right now, or somebody in here that could be not saved. Or not know where they're going to go, or just looking for somebody to help them. And that's our job as Christians, to take people and lead them to God. Because if we don't lead people to God, what do you think God's going to be proud of us when we get into heaven and we have led people to Jesus? I mean, that's a big deal. It's the greatest thing that can ever happen to you. But it seems like in our culture today that we are our own little gods. And that we can save ourselves by good works. We can save ourselves by good works, apparently. I mean, I don't see how that works, because nobody's perfect except for God. But apparently, it's got twisted around so much by the devil, especially lately for what's going on. And it's just stupid that people can do that and twist a world around, call themselves their own little God, and know they're not. And no, they're not God. Nobody can be like God. Nobody can love us that much. Our parents can't love us that much. Our parents love us. And our friends and our pastor. I know our pastor loves us. I mean, he wouldn't spend all his time to prepare a sermon and then go to FCA meets and then come back to church. If he didn't love us, he wouldn't do that. And especially not have a good sermon with the power of God speaking through him. Because there's certain people out there that I can't hardly listen to preach. Because I like to be in an old-fashioned church. I know this is a big church, or fairly sized for where we're at. But it's got that small church feel. And I just thank y'all that y'all have led me in the right way. And that y'all have helped me. And I would just like to say thank you. And thank you to my mom and dad for raising me in a good Christian home and a good Christian way of life. And yes.
Amen.
All right, so last week I was privileged enough to go to Washington, D.C. with my mom and my grandma, because mom was running a marathon, and I got to go into the Supreme Court building inside the courtroom. And I walked in there, I was looking around, and I looked up and saw Moses and the Ten Commandments up there, right front and center of that courthouse. And I thought of what this country was founded on, how we should be, not in this election, sort of holds the future of all the next generations. And I hope that this country turns back to what it was founded on, which is God's Word and God.
Bless you, Pete.
I'm glad I'm saved.
Hey,
next.
Thank God for saving me on June 3rd, 2012.
Amen.
I was asked to read this essay by Kyle. Kyle has asked me to read this. First, I'm just going to say a little bit about it. But a couple weeks ago, our seventh grade class was asked to write an essay that began with the sentence, "The America I Believe In." And then we would fill in the rest of the title. I filled in mine with, "The America I Believe In is a nation that can turn back to God." After we got our essays wrote, we turned them into our teachers. And she chose 10 out of the class, and mine got selected in the 10. An ex, a different teacher, selected 3 more to advance, and I was a part of the 3. Now, hopefully, I'll get selected to go to nationals and place in the top 55 in the nation. But that is the background information. Here's the essay I wrote. The America I Believe In. The America I Believe In is a nation that can turn back to God. Our nation was established on God and founded on godly principles and by godly men. America has been ruined. We are living in perilous times. We need to wake up and come back together as one nation under God. These perilous times that America is experiencing and is going through is not God, and this is not God's ways. This is us, the American people. The only way we can fix this downward slide in America is to trust God again and to turn from our wicked ways and turn back to God. God has blessed America in a mighty and powerful ways and done so much for us. Some people will say that it is not that we are turning away from God, but God is turning his back on America, on us. This is not true. God has never and never will turn his back on America and its people. Amen. Never has he ever gave up on us either. This is us. We are turning our backs on God. In God we trust. What does this quote or slogan even mean to America and its people anymore? When we look at things that consist of this saying, like ambulances, police cars, money, or just the saying alone, do we just use it as the nation's motto? This saying was adopted as Americans' motto for a reason. America needs to turn back to God, and we need to have faith and trust in America that we can turn from this. That we can turn from this and turn back to America, turn back to God. Look at some of the things that has happened to America and the Americans. In 1962 and through 1963, prayer and Bible readings was banned from schools. Some schools wouldn't allow you to mention or say anything having to do with God. Looking at recent things that has happened. In 2016, NFL was saying that it is okay for football players not to stand for the national anthem because they have the right to protest. In my opinion, this is not okay. Christians are being mocked or made fun of for their beliefs. It was once said that a nation that turns their backs on God, their end is near. And I believe that we can turn back to God again and that we can come together as one, as a nation under God. I believe in America. Do you believe? And I back this up with one verse. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive them, forgive their sin, and will heal their land.
Amen. Wait.
Before whoever else, do you stay lining up there? I want to say one thing about this. And first of all, I'm super proud of all of our kids. Aren't you? Amen. I wanted Emily to read that essay that she wrote because they had sent it to me and let me read it, and I thought, wow. The inspiration, the knowledge, the insight, the simplicity yet the complexity,
yes, sir,
of the understanding of a seventh grader to know and understand what this country needs and what this nation needs. And you can't say it any more powerful than to say we need Jesus and we need to get back under the principle of one nation under God. Didn't she do a wonderful job just like all of them did? But what I wanted to share with you that she wasn't going to tell you, and
yes,
this ought to blow our mind. This ought to encourage us of the sense of urgency that our kids are facing. Emily, without hesitating, knew what she wanted to write about and wrote her essay. And it's my understanding you could pick anything you wanted to write about. She chose to write about the sincere situation, the urgency of what we're facing in our country. And from a seventh grade perspective, outlined what we can do to fix it. And never was shy about mentioning God, just like none of these that have spoken already. We're not ashamed, we're not afraid to say we need Jesus, we need the Lord, we need God. But what was so powerful to me is that she was told when she turned in the essay that it was a good essay. It was good, did a good job writing it, but I just want you to know up front, you probably won't have a chance at getting selected. or picked to go on to the next level because you mentioned God in there. And because of the content, you won't have a chance. Just want you to know that up front so you're not disappointed. Isn't that pretty much what they said? And that was before they selected her for the top 10. And then they said, well, you got picked for the top 10, but I doubt that it'll have much chance at the top 3 because of what's in there, the content. It was probably a top 10 pick, but it probably never have a chance at making the top 3. Now she's in the top 3. Could I say that we never should underestimate the power of our kids and our children and our young people? And as Brother Chris has already said a few services ago, they're not the church of tomorrow. They're the church of today. They're the voice of the day. They're the impact of today. No wonder he's working so hard to get an opportunity and every chance that he can have to speak to FCA and to speak to these kids and their parents and their family, because that's an avenue and that's a door to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And could I say, who can tell if God is not using and preparing our children for such a time as this? And aren't you glad that when they said it probably won't get picked, it probably won't be chosen, I beg to differ, because I believe in reality there is a world that is hurting, and there is a world that knows we need something, and there is a world that, whether they're willing to admit it or not, they understand that there is no man, there is no person, there is nothing in this life that can get us through, but what we need is hope, and that hope can come from only Jesus Christ. Paul said, without it, I would be of a man most miserable. And I just want to say, I'm glad that when the teacher didn't think you'd make it, when the teacher didn't think that her essay would go any further, I sure am glad that she didn't go rewrite it. This is what blessed me. She turned it in anyway. She pushed it in anyway. She said, I'm not changing it. I'm not rewriting it. I'm not worried about awards. I'm not worried about trophies. But the fact that you read it and it already got you stirred up, that's enough. God is working through an essay in a seventh grade child. God is working in the life of a kid that would say, I'm thankful for my mom and dad. I'm thankful that I'm saved. I'm glad I'm in a church. We ought to be excited to know that God is working. And I just wanted to tell you the rest of the story. And I highly anticipate that when they didn't expect her to make the top 10, they didn't expect her to make the top 3, I highly anticipate they don't expect you to win, but I think we got a God that's able to do that. And that's not what it's about, but I'm just showing you how good God is. Hey,
Amen. I love you. Thank you for sharing that with us.
I'm glad I'm saved and be able to worship him.
Glad that I know that I'm going to have a place in heaven with God.
Amen. Bless you, buddy. Amen. Bless you, buddy.
Well, first, I'm glad that I was saved. And I thank God that he's always there for me, because if he wasn't, I couldn't be able to do nothing. He's always helped me through my tough times, and if I haven't had him for my family, for everything, I wouldn't know what I would do without him.
Amen, Dylan. Bless you, brother.
I'm glad that I'm saved and I live in a country that allows me to come to church and praise the Lord.
I'd just like to say that I love this church. You guys are all great people, and that
we love you.
And that no matter what happens in this election, it can go one way or the other. We just need to live for God, no matter what who's picked.
I just like to say I'm glad that I'm saved.
Any other young person got something to say? I think I heard Callan back there speaking up a minute ago, didn't I? I think he's going to be a preacher.
I'm glad I'm saved.
I love God, and I'm 6 years old.
Amen.
I just want to say that I'm glad I got saved a couple years ago whenever I was 12.
Stay up here, Kaylin.
I just wanted to say, I thought I was saved when I was 6 years old, and a few years later when I was 11, we were laying in my mom's bed, and we were about to say our prayers, and I felt the conviction really bad, and my heart started beating out of my chest, and I said, Mama, I think I need to get saved, and I kneeled down beside her bed, and I got saved right then and there. And I just wanted to thank the Lord that I was saved.
Amen.
I'm glad that I'm saved.
Amen. Got anything to say, Braden? He's wiping tears back there. That was his sister. Okay, Kelly. Sorry, go ahead, Kelly.
I forgot about it. I just want to say I'm glad to have a great church and a great church family and a great country. And I want to thank God for giving me a talent and that I'm using it for God. And I want to thank my dad for just being just a great dad and telling me when I'm wrong and just doing what the Bible says. And this country, everybody knows it, it's not, it's going downhill, but like that NC said, it can always go back. It just needs God's people in the church to turn back to Him.
Amen.
About six, I thought I was saved. And one Sunday, I was sitting up there, and I told my daddy, I'm not saved. So he took me to the place where I got saved when I was six. And then I said, no, I'm still not saved. And so we came down here, I prayed and I got saved.
You guys want to come say a word? Amen.
When I was six, I thought I'd been saved. And when I was 15, I started dealing with thinking that I wasn't saved. And last October down there, I got with God and got saved.
First of all, I want to thank Pastor Chris for having everything that he's done for this church. I'm glad that I got saved. I got baptized. I'm glad that I have a great family back there. I love you, Mom. I love you, Brandy. I'm really glad to have God on my side and that He's always with me. And I'm glad that I was able to follow Him.
Son, let me tell you what. All these kids right here, they've all got the Holy Spirit in them. Them two right there. They got a talent for the Lord. Every one of these kids has got talent. Just give them all a hand real quick. Just give them all a hand. Bless God. February 21st. I'll never forget this day. I'll never forget this day. I was kneeling on Mom's side of the bed. I thought I'd been saved forever. I wasn't. I was knee-deep in sin. I wasn't getting out. I went downstairs and I was like, Dad, I'm not saved. He said, we need to fix that right now. We kneeled beside Mom's bed. Bless God, I got saved that night. My life's been changed ever since. I ain't never felt different. I feel like a brand new person. And let me tell you, if you ain't saved, bless God, you need to get down on this altar and get saved tonight. You never know if you're going to walk out of these doors and somebody, drunk driver, could hit you. You never know what's going to happen in this world anymore. We are going down. And let me tell you, our country is no good until we get right back on course with God. We are not going to be anything more than just nothing. It'll just be like dust. Just dust. That's all our country's going to be. Just dust. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I mean nothing. If we do not turn around and get in line and get in line with the Lord and follow His path. He gave us the ability to create this country. Now why stray away from Him? What's the point in that? He's keeping all of us alive. I mean, if it wasn't for Him, we wouldn't be walking today.
if it wasn't for his creation, what would we be doing? We wouldn't even be here. We wouldn't have an awesome church and awesome pastors, an awesome band, an awesome church family. I mean, I wouldn't have my mom. I wouldn't have Gavin and Truett's mom. Gosh, I love her. I wouldn't have my dad, my brothers. I wouldn't have any of y'all. And I love everybody. I don't care who you are, where you came from. I don't care if you're still a sinner. I still love you. Heck, I want to get down on this altar and play with you right now. I mean, if you want to, just come up here and I'll just come and be glad to pray with you. Believe me, I hope and pray that if you are lost and dying and going to hell, that you come up here and get saved and join me on the road to heaven. Bless God, I can't wait to start walking the streets of gold. I'm going to be rejoicing and high up on cloud nine with Pastor Chris when I get out of there. I'll be with Braden, Kelly, I'll be with every one of these kids. Bless God, I'll be with my mom. I'll get to see my granny, my papa. I'll get to see all of them. I'll get to see millions of people that are going up to heaven with me. I mean, if you're watching on anything right now, I just hope that you get down on your knees right now and just ask the Lord to save your soul. Because that's really the only thing you need to do. It's just ask Him, just ask Him into your heart. It's just this one simple prayer. Just ask Him, would you come into my heart? Tell Him that you're sorry for sinning. And if you really truly mean it, you're going to accept Him into your heart, and that door is going to open up, and He's going to fill that hole, that deep, deep, deep hole that has been in your heart forever. Ever since you came out of the womb, there is a hole in your heart till you get saved, and you got to get it filled. Bless God, if you ain't got it filled, you're just going to hell. Like Dad said this morning, most preachers, they don't worry about preaching on hell. We need to teach people about hell. I think if we do that, it'll lead them straight to heaven. They're going to get so scared of hell that they don't want to go there. They're going to know that it's an eternal burning. You will not be able to do anything besides get tortured, and you will be asking for thirst. Your mouth will be so dry that you will just want one little drop of water, just one, and you're not going to get it. You'll just be asking and begging God to please bring you up. But He's not going to, because you're a sinner and you're down in hell. And you're going to just be wishing that you had that one extra minute to say that prayer and get Him into your heart and fill that hole, that deep hole in your heart that you know you should have filled. And I don't know if, like, my mom doesn't even know this, but I get down by my bed almost every night whenever nobody's in the room, and I'll sit there and I just think about my uncle and all the sinners that I know. I'll just sit there and think, God, please save them. I know you can. I know you can convict him. I know you can convict all of them. I know you can bring him to you, Lord. Just please do it. Before he dies, I want him to join me in heaven. Bless God, I can't wait till that happens. Yes. I'll be happier than any kid on this planet. I just want to say thank you for everything that y'all have done for my family. Bless God, in the Bible it says, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. But he's never left my family. Obviously, he's never left this church. He's been here ever since the beginning. And he's never forsaken my family. He's never forsaken any of us. And he'll always love you. It don't matter who you are, where you came from. He will always love you. Amen.
He's always got a spot for everybody. He doesn't pick favorites. He doesn't. He loves every one of us as much as he loves the other. But bless God. All I want to say is just thank you. Thank you for everything. I mean everything. Especially you, Chris. You've helped me so much. You've been an idol to me. All y'all have, all the Christians in this place has just been an idol to me. And whenever I was younger, I'd always thought I was saved. Oh yeah, I'm going to heaven. No, I wasn't. That was just something that I just believed. I mean, I was just at Bible camp one year and I was just like, well, I might as well get saved. I didn't even ask him into my heart. I didn't even say a prayer or anything. I just thought I was saved. Went up there, said, oh, I'm saved. Bless God, whenever I kneel by my mom's bedside, I got saved. I'm talking, the Lord came down on that place. Like, there's not going to be a day in my life that I don't think about that. It was the best night of my life that I think I've ever had so far. What's going to be pretty good is when my uncle and all the other people in sinning, way down deep in sin, get saved and they just get lifted up into heaven with me. Bless God. Our little foster kids. Gosh, I love that little boy. Look at him. He's so cute. Right there. That's my little buddy, Aaron, right there. They're so just the Lord's creation right there. Just one day he's going to grow up and just remember that we've took him to church and we've at least gave him a little advice on church. We grew him, we let him grow up in our home, a godly home filled with the Lord. And maybe one day he'll just turn out to be the godliest man on earth. I mean, heck, you never know. He could just be a healer, I guess. God just give him powers or something. I know he can. It's possible. Anything's possible when you believe in the Lord. Aaron could be the smartest person on the earth. Anything, as long as he's saved and I'm in heaven and I'm looking down on that kid. And he's living, I don't care how he's living, as long as he is saved, I'm going to be the happiest person ever. Thank you.
Bless you, Lane. Love you, buddy.
I just want to say that I got saved on April 8th, and something else that we need to pray about the election coming up.
I struggled for a while not knowing if I was saved or not, but I'm just thankful that 3 years ago I got saved, and I know without a doubt that I'm saved now. And I also have an uncle that's living in sin, and if he don't get saved, he's going to hell. I just pray he gets saved.
Praise God.
I just want to say I'm glad I'm saved.
Yes, you're right.
Thank you, Lord.
I think it's safe to say there's a remnant. I'm so honored. I'm so honored and so privileged and so blessed to stand in a place where this is going on. I'm just a few years older than y'all, but I am so proud to be a part of a church where we have a group of kids who aren't afraid to stand on truth. Brayden and Kelly, I know without a doubt that it was your prayers for your Uncle Sean that got him in this altar this morning. You keep praying. You have a power in prayer. These kids got up here and they're talking about their family members that aren't saved. They have a heart for the lost. I have so many in my family and so many friends who do not know the Lord. And I feel that heartbreak right along with them. But no matter what happens this coming Tuesday, no matter who gets elected, I believe that God has his hand on this place, on each one of these children. I believe tonight God's given us a glimpse of our future leaders, our future pastors, singers, teachers. God gave me a verse of scripture here in Isaiah 41 and verse 9. It says, "Thou whom I have taken from the ends of the earth and called thee from the chief men thereof, and said unto thee, Thou art my servant. I have chosen thee and not cast thee away." Each one of you has been handpicked by the Lord. Each one of you has a calling on your life. And it is my prayer for you tonight and from now on that you step out into that and you claim that calling. Don't give up on Jesus. I go into the high school every day and I see kids who are broken, who have they've never really heard the name of Jesus. They've never heard about God unless it's at the end of a curse word. What you have in this church is special. It doesn't happen everywhere. I've had the honor and privilege of going to a lot of places. God's given me a talent that I've been able to use in a lot of places. And this does not happen everywhere. I'm proud of you. And I'm honored that we have two godly leaders in this church, Pastor Chris and Pastor Kyle. I'm honored to have elders in this church who were not afraid to step out in faith when they heard the voice of God. Brother Leonard, Brother Paul, thank you for not being afraid to heed the call of God. Thank you. It is your obedience and your faithfulness. That's the reason we're in this building now. I know many times in my life I've gotten discouraged when it looked like I wasn't going to make much out of my life. And I know that sometimes down there in this little storefront church, maybe sometimes you got a little burdened, thinking, "Well, God, what are you doing? Where are we going?" But through faith and through prayer, look where we are today. I'm so thankful for you all. When I came into this church about 3 years ago, I was a broken mess. I was in such darkness. I was like that blind beggar on the side of the road. And I have never felt such love and such encouragement as I have felt from this church. And I'm so honored and blessed to be here for such a time as this. And I believe that God is going to do great things with this place. I have prayed and I have had the conviction for a long time that revival is so near we can almost reach out and touch it. I believe that the ground is beginning to shake. I believe God is getting ready to do something phenomenal in this land. Because you can go through the children in this country. You cannot get a child to stand, a teenager to stand on a stage for 10 minutes and preach to you the word of God. That just doesn't happen on its own. That happens when the hand of God is upon that teenager, that child. And I heard some familiar words when these kids were speaking. Words that I've heard you all say in your praise. Your children are listening. I promise you that. They're watching you. And I'm so proud of each and every one of you. And I'm proud to be a part of you. And I'm excited about what God's going to do.
Any other young? Any other young person got something? Well, I want all the young people, maybe you don't have to say anything, but I want y'all just to line this stage up here in the front. Just come on around and line up. Take a good look. This is a good reason why you ought to vote biblical principles on Tuesday. If we vote for someone that's pro-abortion, pro-choice, and if they'd have been in all during our lives, maybe these kids wouldn't have been here. It's already been said. I'm not going to preach. Brother Kyle, I'd ask him. I said, could you take the service? And then this morning I said, you know what? I said, I really feel like we need to let our young people speak tonight. I said, because this is going to be our last chance to affect our church when they go vote. But not only, we should have probably done it this morning. Maybe I was late on hearing from God. But there's people watching online right now. And I want you to take a good look at across this stage. These kids are counting on you. They're counting on the people that claim to be Christian to do the right thing. And I'm counting on these kids not only to speak up in a church house, but to speak up in a schoolhouse. Amen? Speak up wherever they're at. And I'm going to tell you something. I believe there's a few preachers, or maybe all of them preachers in here. Our Sunday school teachers are doing a great job. I'm telling you, preachers are doing a good job. Some of the same words that I say, I've heard some of them say. Some of the same words Brother Kyle says. I heard that in my ear tonight. And that's what we want, don't we? We want them doing what we do if we're doing it right. So I challenge you tonight. And if anybody here needs to be saved, anybody here needs anything from God, we want to welcome you to these altars tonight. Even if you stood up here on this stage and you got something you want to pray about, you just come on. We're going to stand to our feet. Brother Luke, go ahead.
Sure, hold on. Before he sings, I'm not going to keep you much longer, but I got this on my heart, and while they're still standing up here with me, the Bible said in Jeremiah... Let me go to Ezekiel first. Ezekiel said, I sought for a man among them. I looked for somebody that would stand in the gap and that would make up the hedge. And in Ezekiel's day, the scripture ended, Brother Ken, in that verse. He said, I looked and I sought, and I was looking for somebody that would stand there and that would fill the void and it would go in the place and it would do what needed to be done. And I looked and I sought and I found none. And I, as I listened to them speak tonight, I was encouraged and convicted all at the same time. And one of them said, we know, we all know, we know the direction, we know the path that this country has taken, we know the steps that are taking place. And I thought about I thought about what will these kids be able to say in 20 or 30 years when they look back and they're the leaders in the church, and what will they be able to say to their kids and their grandkids and their churches? Will they be able to say that somebody stood in the gap, that somebody prayed, that somebody, regardless of who gets a ticket, regardless of who gets in the White House, will they be able to say that our church and our community and our country came together and somebody stood up and stood in the gap? Somebody made a decision to fast, and somebody made a decision to pray. And I know it's been mentioned by several others, and it's been posted, and many on a global stance, many on a national platform have called and asked for Christians and churches to pray and to fast. And Brother Chris and I talked about this, and can I say, listen, we talk about it a lot and it's in the Bible, but we don't really do it a lot. And I'm asking you, if God touches your heart and God leads you to do so, if you can, you're not a bad person, but if God leads you to do so and God gives you a burden and a urgency on your heart, I'm asking you. The Bible said there's some things that can't come out except by prayer and fasting. Can I put that in good country terms for you? Can I put that in Hayesville, North Carolina speech? There's some things you can't get from God on a full stomach.
That's right. Amen. Yes, sir.
There's some things you can't get from God asleep. There's some things that you'll only get from God when you're willing to give up something here. And I'm asking you to fast.
Yes.
I'm asking you to pray tomorrow and Tuesday, and not just until the decision's made, but I'm asking you to continue doing it even after the decision's made, because we need prayer and we need God.
Yes, sir.
And can I leave you with this? Jeremiah asked a question. He said, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? And the answer was yes. Yes, there is a balm. Yes, there is an answer. Yes, there is a cure. How many of you believe that tonight? There is an answer, and there is a hope, and there is a physician, and his name is Jesus. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the first, Brother Ken, and he's the last. He's the author, and get this, he's the finisher of our faith.
Yes.
Look at somebody sitting beside you and tell them, God's writing my story. Come on, help me out. He's the author. He's the finisher. God's writing this thing. He's the one holding the pen. But he said, my people that are called by my name have got to be the ones that seek my faith. He said, is there no balm? Is there no physician? And if there is, then why is the health of the daughter of my people not recovered? And I'm going to ask these kids as they stand up here, I believe we need to pray. And if you've got a need, if you've got a burden, if you've got something that you need to pray about that's personal, most importantly, if you're not saved, today is the day of salvation. I beg you to come and get in this altar. But as a church, I'm begging you to come get in this altar and let's pray for our country. Let's stand in the gap for our country. See, it doesn't take a whole nation. The Bible said where two or three gather together in his name, he's in the midst. And I want us to come together tonight and pray and call on God like you've never called on him before. And this is the last thing I got that was laid on my heart. As you come, I want you to whisper along with us. As you come, I want you to whisper it as you head to this altar. And I've asked Jacob to help me because he prays this prayer every night. And I want our young people, if you know this, as we bow our heads and close our eyes, if you know it, I want you to say it as loud as you can with us. If you don't know it, you just lip along. If you only know part of it, get through as much of it as you can. And I'm going to ask the congregation, as these children up here lead us in the Lord's Prayer. I want you to whisper it with them as you come and get in this altar and really call out on God tonight, not only for these kids, but for our schools, for our country, for our church, for our leaders. How many of you will do that tonight? How many of you believe? The Bible said, the disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. And he started it out like this.
Father, church in heaven, hallowed be the name. The kingdom come, that will be done on earth as is in heaven. Give us this day your daily bread. Give us this day as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not in temptation. Live for you in power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Father, we thank you so much.
God, lately I've been looking back along this winding road to the old familiar markers of the mercies I know it may sound simple, but it's more than a cliche. There's no other words to tell you than to say God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood. 'Cause through it all, God's been good. Times are playing, I can see. I've cried some bitter tears, but I felt his arms around me as I face my greatest fears. I've had more gains than losses, and I've known more joy than hurt as his grace rolls down upon me undeserved. 'Cause God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood. 'Cause through it all, God's been good. God has been my Father, he's my Savior and my friend. His love is my beginning, and his love will be my end. I could spend forever trying to tell you everything he is, but the best way that I can tell you is this. God's been good in my I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood. 'Cause through it all, God's been good. God has been my Father, he's my Savior and my friend. His love is my beginning, and his love will be my end. I could spend forever trying to tell you everything he is, but the best way that I can tell you is this. God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. Though I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood. 'Cause through it all, God's been good.
I was just wanting to say that when I came up here, I was a little uncomfortable because I'm not used to, like, you know, talking up to everybody. But I didn't get to say that. Like, my dad has sacrificed everything for me. He does so much for me, and sometimes it just gets me so sad, like how, what he does, and he gets me stuff, and like my mom, she barely gets anything, and like my sister, she, when someone's talking bad about me, she takes up for me, and I love how they treat me. They've always helped me, gave me confidence about everything. And I've always been, like, this election, I've always been scared because in the Bible it says that no woman can control man. And I've never felt comfortable. And my dad and my mom has helped me through everything. She ain't here because my brother and sister's sick. And I've loved them for everything they've done for me. They spend stuff for me, and I won't.
I love you, buddy.
I didn't get to say this morning, he. Aren't you thankful for your pastor? I'm thankful for his friendship. Thankful that he's a mentor. Thankful that he's a brother. He's a man of God. Come on, you can do better than that. I love you, my friend. I appreciate you. I appreciate this church. And I want to say, Sally and I were so overwhelmed today, and we don't deserve your love. We don't deserve your gratitude, and we are forever indebted to each and every one of you. We love you so much, and thank you so much for all the cards and the gifts and the thoughts and the hugs, and just y'all have been so amazing to us. I told her, I said, we've only been there a few months, and they act like we've been there for 10 years. And we're so appreciative for that, and we love you, but I just wanted to take a minute and say that I love you, Chris, and I appreciate you and your leadership and your time and your prayer and thoughts. A good man of God, and we need to continue to pray for him. Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, I could brag on all of you. But, boy, what a good day. I'm telling you, I don't have the words. I'm not going to try to find some right now. I'm blessed. I am blessed. Oh, my. I think we ought to do this once a month, whether they want to do it or not, don't you? I mean, really. Come on. How do you tell your mom and daddy no?
She's too bashful. I'll say it all, I guess. I just want you to know that I was really blessed this morning. We've been praying a long time, and I tell you, this woman here has prayed a whole lot for Sean.
Yeah. Yep.
And I have too. And I had a bunch of them in my little prayer room up at the shop or outside there, and I had a bunch of little stickers under a hood, matter of fact, and I'd go out there and get under it. And I still got them up there, praying for the church and new people and all, and I had Sean up there. One of them's done. I got six more that I had on my mind, praying my neighbors and all to get saved. Sean rededicated, and oh, it's been a burden off your part. Everybody knows. You know, me and Gary Wilson would request prayer for our boys in the prayer room.
Yeah.
And mine's come back, and I've not heard. Where's Gary at tonight? I see him. Okay. And let's keep praying for him, because we sort of connect and pray for each other's boy. And gosh, it was so good this morning when he come up. Because I've really never seen him too emotional, had you, sure, Chris? And he is very emotional. And let's, y'all pray for him. He was down there, and he said, I got a lot of things to change. Yeah. Well, let God change them for you.
That's right.
So we just thank you. Thank God for Chris, Pastor's Appreciation Day, my oldest. Got three good sons, Nick and Sean, and God's blessed us with four grandkids. And
all mine.
Yeah. I've been hoping for more, but it's hard to get them. They ain't married, so. Anyway, we love y'all. We all prayed, I'm sure, for Sean a lot. And just keep praying. We need two more daughter-in-laws, you know, to come. That's what I want. Many grandkids. And I love my grandkids, and these kids up here a while ago, I couldn't hardly stand it. That's about all them. I teach about 19 of them, and I didn't know they could talk like that. They don't never talk. I mean, they talk, but it ain't that. Each other, maybe. But I mean about the Lord, and Emily done also. Because Emily, I don't know if she said a word in my class or not. But we thank God for them, and God can use all of them. And I just thank God. I can't name them all. I love them all. We just about had preaching out a lot of them, didn't we?
Yes, sir.
So I just want to thank the church. I love all of you. Thank God for you. Love my family. And God's good is all I can say.
Amen. Thank you, Dad. Praise the Lord. If any of you single women out there online are looking for good Christian men, I couldn't resist it. Oh, boy. See if there's any likes or loves going across. You know how they do that on social media? Oh, that's hilarious. You can tell I've had a long day. It's been a great day. 27 souls saved. My brother coming back home, the prodigal. And I will tell you the whole story. Mom and Dad doesn't know the whole story. Nobody knows the whole story besides me and my brother, Sean, and God, about how that God opened up a great door for me to minister to him yesterday. And it is a beautiful story. And so I'm thankful for that. I'm not saying anything else. God's been good. Amen. We got November 26th, the FCA concert. I was serious when I said, hey, we need people to step out and come to the concert. I need other pastors and preachers to get on board. Because, and listen, I'm going to tell you something. I believe the devil's really fighting the concert. We've already got a couple of things that we're trying to hurdle over. That's the devil, because now with 27 more souls, that puts us at 200 kids saved since July 28th. 200. 200. And I would love for that number to be at 1,000 before we end school. I mean, it could be. It's just going to be doors open up. And they're continuing to open up. College football teams are calling now and wanting us to come speak. Just had a college call. Carson Newman called and said, could you come? I couldn't go, but they're calling. So you know, the doors are going to continue open up. And I've talked with Kyle. I said, Kyle, I want to get you involved with FCA. And some of the guys in our church I've talked to about getting involved, and it's wonderful. Matter of fact, Colleen's little girl, she's playing for Peachtree School, and she comes to school here at CCA, but she's too young to be on the CCA team, and she comes to church here, of course, and she is leading prayer with her little basketball team. Amen. And the coach said, I can't do that, and she said, I'll do it. And she's been getting all the little girls together and leading them in prayer. So I had a talk with her today. Amen. Y'all going to get me started. You don't want me to get started right now. I'm telling you, I will be here all night. Now I'm thinking what I was going to say. I even wrote down fast before service on my hand, fast, and he knew I forgot about it. But that little girl, I told her, I said, listen, I'm going to bring you something because you're going to be the huddle leader for your basketball team. I'm going to bring you something that you can use. So I'm so proud of that. And, you know, let me throw this in. I used this several years ago in a sermon I was preaching. And it talked about this fellow that was walking the beach and all the starfish had rolled up on the beach. And he was out there and he was picking one up and he was throwing it. And he was throwing one. And a guy came along and said, what do you think you're doing? You can't save them all. And he went, save that one. Picked up another one. Save that one. Amen. You see these kids on this stage? Hey, listen, when you get down and you think you're not doing a good job and you think maybe that the church is just not doing like it ought to do, remember tonight.
Yes, sir.
Because that devil's a discourager. He's a deceiver. And you remember, hey, we might not win every kid in every high school around here and every middle school. We won that one.
Yes, sir.
And that one. I believe God's going. I'm like Brother Matthew. I believe God's sending revival.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about unity revival. I'm not talking about camp meeting. I'm talking about out of nowhere on God's schedule, not on ours. And revival comes to this place like never before. And I'm believing that. I am trusting in the Lord for that. I feel the Holy Ghost right now just talking about it. Hallelujah. Y'all ain't. He's feeling it too. I'm telling you, I am looking to see God pour out His Spirit as never before on this place. Matter of fact, I had wrote down, I didn't tell you this morning, next week, it's up to you that are here. Three people, I want you picking out three people this week while you're fasting for this country. Three people that you're going to bring to church with you next Sunday. Three people that you're going to bring to church with you next Sunday. It might be one of your spouses. You're going to bring them. They don't come. It might be your neighbor. It might be that uncle. It might be that uncle. And let me tell you guys, some of you talking about your uncles needing. I know little Leonard there, Lane, talking about how that he wanted his uncle saved. Listen, when I was just around 12 years old, Brother Rick, who is now chairman of the deacon board, I prayed for him. He's my uncle. I prayed for him and prayed for him. He had erred from the Lord. And let me tell you something. I remember that time when I loaded up in the altar behind my uncle who came and knelt down and prayed. And boy, just tears flowing. And I remember just, I couldn't even hardly talk because I was so happy. And I told my kids a few years ago, I told them that story. And I said, God answered my prayers and God will answer yours. You just stay faithful to praying. You stay faithful to praying. Hallelujah. Ain't God good? Give God a hand clap of praise tonight. Hallelujah. Anything, Brother Lucas? Don't have anything. Remember Thursday night, but we'll announce it again on Wednesday night. Remember, November 26th, got to get out. Got to get people to that concert, okay? Let's get our hands up in the air. Let's exercise. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. May God bless you. Good night.